Welcome to Jack Talk. I'm Tegan Mingo, and on today's show, we're going to be talking with the new SFA president, then getting a look at the groundbreaking ceremony for a new elementary school, and finally going over some self-defense. Stay tuned. This is Jack Talk. Welcome back, folks. Let's start things off by talking to the new SFA president, Dr. Scott Gordon.
Hi, Dr. Gordon.
Hello, how are you?
Good, how are you doing today?
I'm doing great.
That's good. Well, congratulations is in order for you being our new SFA president.
Thank you.
All right, no problem. But I think we're all wondering, what led you here to SFA?
Well, it was a multitude of things. First and foremost, the reputation of the institution. I had SFA on my radar as far back as 1988. And knew of the institution, knew of some individuals who had taught at SFA, and over the years I've kind of kept track of the reputation of SFA, as well as some of the focus on student recruitment and retention and student success in general, and that was very attractive to me.
All right, well, that's actually good to know that we've been on your radar for a long time. I feel honored to experience this actually right now. But actually, what prepared you for your position as being a university president?
Well, I don't think there was any one thing that prepared me. I think that it was a multitude of life experiences. I grew up in a very small town, and I grew up in an era where everybody knew what you had done before you even got home, and your parents, before your parents found out, and that kind of built this idea that you're accountable and you're being held accountable. And as I went through my various career tracks with graduate school and then my first position as a university professor, those kinds of backgrounds really stayed with me. And I felt as though I was always going to be held accountable, and I held myself accountable and even really at a higher standard than others. And so throughout the career that I've had in higher education, I've been involved with a lot of different aspects, from athletics to student affairs to development of new and innovative programs across the spectrum, not just in the science areas where my training was, but really across the entire spectrum of the university. And so I think, you know, developing those experiences and the ability to learn about all aspects of the university has really prepared me well. And again, you know, as a president, you really have to know and understand all aspects of the institution, from athletics to the fine arts to forestry and agriculture to the sciences, education. And so my experiences over the last 20, it's been about 26 years now that I've been involved with higher education, really have all led up to this point.
You sound very well-rounded. Like, also, you are definitely prepared for this position. And I mean, I don't know, like, I just didn't even know about the spectrum since I'm not in that position yet.
Right.
Or maybe I will be.
Maybe you will be.
Maybe I will be.
Dreams.
But dreams, we're gonna dream big. But what are your plans for SFA overall? Mm-hmm.
Well, I think first and foremost, at least for the next few months and maybe even into spring semester, really looking at what is working, what isn't working, meeting with various groups across campus. You know, for instance, yesterday I met with the department chairs and really had a good conversation about things that we need to look at to help our students be successful, things that we need to look at to reduce barriers for our students for registering for classes, for achieving the success that we want for all of the students. And I also want to look at how can we as a university be more integrated with the community, with business and industry, more entrepreneurial, able to pivot in a world that's really changing very quickly. And I think that a lot of individuals that I've talked to are excited about that opportunity, excited to see how we can do things differently, maybe even better. And one of the philosophies that I have is never to say no initially. A lot of times when people are asking for wanting to do something or another thing, they get, no, we can't do that. I think we need to look at how might we? How might we look at things differently? What are the lenses that we can look at things through and really see how SFA can become what I refer to as the model of the new American university, a university that's nimble, a university that's entrepreneurial, and a university that is 100% focused on student success.
Okay, sounds like you definitely have a lot of plans for this, and I'm really excited to see what we have going forward into the next semester and on the future mm-hmm. as well, because it sounds brilliant, actually.
And I would ask all lumberjacks out there, on October 16th in the morning, I believe it's 8:30 a.m., there'll be information about this. I'm going to have a breakfast with the president session where students will be invited to come in and talk with me. And I want to hear from the students, learn what's working and what's not working, and ideas and opportunities that they think the university has to be better.
So this is a time for students to share their voices,
Absolutely.
Opinions, and let them be heard.
Absolutely.
I know I'm definitely not going to miss that opportunity. That's
Great.
Actually really brilliant. You did talk about your plans, of course, and the few issues that you see. Is there any other issues you've seen so far that might need to be brought to light?
I don't necessarily want to categorize them as issues, mm-hmm. but maybe opportunities. And I think what we're looking at are some opportunities to really transform SFA in a way that really will help our students be successful. That's what we're here for. That's what I've dedicated my career to is success. You know, I was a first-generation college student. And I guess I still am a first-generation college student because I'm always learning. And when I went to college, I had no idea what a registrar was. I had no idea what some of the various offices were or some of the things that occurred during the process to register for classes, get dropping classes, adding classes, those kinds of things. And I think we can do a better job helping students through some of these barriers or hurdles and really making the SFA experience an experience next to nothing else.
Okay, because you're literally telling us like what we're going through already. So since you've mm-hmm. experienced it, it makes it more of a closer experience. Mm-hmm. Especially for me, I'm also a first generation college student, so I came in mm-hmm. blind. But that makes mm-hmm. me so excited for the future
and
of SFA.
Now your eyes are wide open.
Definitely, they are definitely wide open. What is your ultimate goal? Like just one goal, or what would you say for the future of SFA mm-hmm. in your hands, of course?
I want SFA to be the national model for student success, where institutions and representatives from institutions across the country are coming here and saying, how are you doing it? How did you do it? And we want to emulate what SFA is doing because you've got it right.
All right. Well, before we go, of course, is there anything else you want to say to our lumberjacks?
Ask them, Jack.
All right. Thank you for being here so much. Thank you so much for your time, Dr. Gordon,
Thank
and this
you.
Insight. This was definitely an honor for sure, and I guess it gives everyone a nice good point of view as well to see what's going on. But all right, we're going to take a short break now, but when we come back, we're going to be looking into a new elementary school. Stay tuned. If you're just tuning in, we're going to show you footage from the groundbreaking ceremony on the new Carpenter Elementary School.
I am ready to go with the message of inspiration, and the future is definitely looking bright for these students. Students and faculty gathered at the groundbreaking ceremony of the new Emmeline Carpenter Elementary School. Classes held different color shovels with students' names signed on them to represent the different colors of each grade's hallway in the new building. T-shirts were also donated for every student and teacher to wear to commemorate the event. In 2018, the Nacogdoches Independent School District passed a bond that included rebuilding the elementary school. Now, over a year later, the groundbreaking ceremony has taken place to celebrate the construction. Here is what Dr. Alton Fraley had to say about the event.
This occasion makes it all worth it. This is amazing. This is indeed an historic occasion here for our city, for our entire community. This is the start of another chapter in the beautiful story that we call Emmeline Carpenter.
The new school is set to be open in August 2020. For Jack Talk, I'm Bethany Petty.
Wow, that looked like a good time. With us now is Miss Erin Windham to talk more about it. Welcome.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. It's exciting.
Oh, this is exciting for sure. How are you doing today?
Great.
Good. All right. Well, can you tell us a little bit about Carpenter Elementary?
Yes. I came to Emmeline Carpenter year before last as a community liaison for the school. I did not know much about it, but once I got there, I fell in love with the teachers and the children in the neighborhood. The building itself was built in 1965, so it's been there a long time. And the neighborhood, it's kind of outgrown its neighborhood. So the things that they covered on the groundbreaking as a result of some positive things that's gone on that's brought us to the point of now we're going to get to rebuild it on a site that's worthy of the,
You're good. But before we get into the groundbreaking, we understand how to be proposed, of course. So how was the process for that? We know it got passed in 2018, right? So like processing it, like how many proposals were offered before we took the next step for a new elementary school?
So the bond that passed in 2018 was the third bond in, 15 to 20 years. I think 01 was the last time we had one actually pass in Nacogdoches. So the last two that took place that were voted on and actually failed, the amount of voters that showed up to vote in both of those elections combined was still less than the amount of yes votes for our 2018 bond proposal that actually passed. So a lot of people came out in favor and the community showed their support for the school district for all the projects that were proposed. It was really exciting.
That's good. If we have community background, like we have a good future.
Yes.
So it's just a long process of the making, of course, but at least we have it now. So why do we have a relocation going on for the elementary?
So what I was wanting to get to a second ago is the fact that that school is landlocked. There's not a good spot to really add on. There's not a good spot to put parking in. The traffic gets really backed up. I don't know if you've ever driven through there when we release the kids. Traffic patterns are a problem. And basically, our other campuses have some better bones, structurally speaking, than this particular campus. And so there's some things that facilities has done a great job maintaining as best they can, but it's like outgrown itself. And in terms of years, there's just nothing else more that could be done without completely rebuilding it. So for the convenience of the land and to be able to make it accessible to more parents and to really be able to build the building that needs to be, we moved it to a more accessible location where there can be ample parking and playground and accessibility to everyone that's zoned for that school.
Okay, cool. So we did say that having access to the school was mainly a priority for everyone. Mm-hmm. Why exactly was getting this passed, a little bit more detail, of course, if you can explain, why was this getting it passed more important for like the community, the students overall?
So the process that the district took with Mr. Fraley's guidance was to be able to explain the needs to the community members and let them know what the situation was at the facilities. I think it was important for the community to take a trip. They actually took a field trip interested community members were able to go take a tour of the facilities and see what exactly we were talking about the need was. And so then they were able to make a decision, an educated, informed decision based on what they saw with their own two eyes. And the children needed to see that the community was supporting them. And I think that's, you know, one of the issues people say, how does this back up? How does this benefit the kids, the bottom line? They're gonna be taught by our awesome teachers no matter what kind of building we were in. But for the community to take ownership of the school district and to be able to say, you know what, we can do better for our kids and give these kids a facility that they deserve.
That's good, because when you have a community backing education, it pushes students to be the best they can be. And that's what they need, especially being so young. From what like grade point does it go from, like kindergarten to fifth maybe?
Currently it's pre-K through fifth. It will be kindergarten through fifth because we're going to create a pre-K center at Fredonia Elementary, and all pre-K for the town will be at that one centralized location for continuity of curriculum and streamline our process for pre-K instruction.
All right, that sounds really good, of course. Like, I'm looking forward to it, to see the next elementary within the next couple years, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Like 2020, 2019, like late, 21.
Well, as I'm sure you know, these projects don't happen overnight, and there's a lot going on in the background. So, I don't know what the exact projection date for the finished product will be, but yeah, I'd say a couple of years, definitely.
All right, well, we are definitely looking forward to it. We're looking forward for our little ones, of course, future lumberjacks, hopefully,
yes,
to have a good future here at Carpenter. Thank you so much for coming in today.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you, let us know, for everything. And it's great to hear about the new elementary school in Nacogdoches. Now we get back from this break, we're going to learn more about self-defense. Thank you. Hey folks, this is Jack Talk. With us now is Jonathan Sanders of the Judo Club to talk about self-defense. Welcome, Jonathan.
Thank you.
How are you doing today?
Oh, I'm doing pretty well.
Yeah. All right, that's good. Can you tell us about yourself a little bit?
I am a senior here at SFA. I'm also the president of the Judo Club here. I'm a psychology major with a theater minor. Okay. And yeah, I've been doing judo. This is the fourth year that I've been doing judo, and I really love it. Almost all of my training for judo has come from here. I've outsourced to different gyms for other martial arts. I'm really interested in MMA, but for judo, this is a really good place for it. So I've done most of my learning for judo here.
Oh, all right, nice experience, and I'm glad that we're providing it. But can you tell us a little bit, what is judo?
Judo is a grappling martial art that focuses on stand-up grappling, as opposed to jiu-jitsu, which specializes in ground grappling, which is more popular in MMA, just slightly. But judo is the stand-up grappling, more common amongst kickboxers and people who want to learn self-defense. It's been named the perfect self-defense martial art because of its extreme mechanical advantages that really transcend weight classes when done effectively. Most martial arts, such as kickboxing, have 6, maybe 7 weight classes. Judo has 3. And it's pretty much in the range of 150 to 200, below that and above that.
Versatile.
Yes.
Right. So that's exactly why we have you here today, to teach us a little self-defense. Your favorite moves are what you recommend when we are out and about and we need to protect ourselves. Today we have our lovely member, Brian, here to be sparring with you or partnering up with you. And go ahead and show us your moves.
So I'm going to start with something called a drop seinagi, or drop shoulder throw in English. Some application reasons for this is a good throw from whenever someone's behind you. So say someone's trying to grab your neck from behind you, you're just minding your business, you see an arm coming around, you're like, oh no, you're actually already in a very good position to just grab the elbow and drag him over your hip so that he's on the ground and you're not. From there, you have a lot more options than you did before. Your options before were get choked or hopefully try to run away. That might not work. But now that he's on the ground, I could use pepper spray. I could kick him, you know, whatever you want. Just run away even. So it's very good for self-defense. If someone's trying to grab you from forward like this, and I just can't get him off of me, and he's being very persistent, then I might want to try a hip throw, because I know that I can do this effectively. It doesn't fail very often at all, so I know that it's reliable. So he's coming at me. I'm just going to step through, grab around his torso, and swing him down. And now I've got him on the ground. I can put a knee in his ribs if I want to keep him there until the cops come. And there's just a lot of advantages to being the higher one who's not on the ground. Apart from that, there are throws from pretty much every angle. Say someone is trying to grab you with both hands on one arm, which is, I believe, the most common way that adults are kidnapped. A man jumps out of a van, grabs your arm like that. Instead of trying to fight back, where he might be stronger than me, I'm going to step in, step behind, and I'm going to lift up both legs. And I won't do it to Brian, because he's been nice to me, but just drop him on their head, essentially. That's called the double leg or pants leg throw. I can't remember the Japanese name for it. But yeah, so there, what judo does, essentially, whenever you're in a crisis situation, it gives you a lot of options. And those options are things that you didn't have earlier. So thank you so much, Brian.
So as you were saying, it's a good self-defense. So what are the advantages exactly, like, for someone like me? I'm not the same weight as Brian, of course, but...
That's true. So the main advantage with judo is the mechanical advantage. And what that means, in layman's terms, is if you are shorter than somebody, or if you can just get your center of mass below theirs, you no longer have to be strong to throw them on the ground. And that can be really, really helpful, say, if you weigh 100 pounds less than the person who's attacking you. Because all you have to do is squat down a little bit and know how to initiate the mechanical advantages through technique. And from there, you can really control someone much, much larger than you in a safe way to keep yourself safe, which is why it has been named the perfect self-defense martial art.
I wouldn't have thought that. So it has everything to do with, like, body, like your body movements and placements. I don't have to go and bench, like, 200 pounds in order for me to be able to protect myself.
No, in fact, here on campus, when we compete with each other, just in friendly competition, which we call Rindori, it's women, men of all sizes competing together, and you really don't know who's going to win. It's not as easy as saying, oh, he's bigger, so he's going to win. It's really who practiced more, essentially, and who's been paying more attention. So it's really about the work that you put into it instead of, you know, your muscle mass or anything like that. And I know I might not be the best representation of that because I'm not very small. But
that's okay.
But we do have people of very varied size within our club and within judo competitions in general. So it's really great for self-defense because of that.
Did you have a favorite move that you would use for self-defense that you didn't show us?
My favorite move is just, it's called the hip spring.
The hip spring,
it's
right?
It's kind of hard to pull off, which is why I wouldn't recommend it for self-defense.
Okay, cool.
But it is a lot of fun. It's essentially a hip throw that forces a downward acceleration. So instead of them just dropping, it adds rotational speed to the drop.
Oh yeah, I guess we don't need Brian involved with that, because that sounds like that's going to be epic to see, but not as pleasant for Mr. Brian.
Yeah, I could show other things, but yeah, I'm pretty much out of safe ones.
That's okay. Look, you showed some safe ones, ones that look like we could pick up easily and quickly to protect ourselves, because I know that there has been 10 reported cases actually on campus about assault, so this is actually good for anyone who is dealing with it, of course.
Yes, and that's probably why we usually tend to have at least 50%, but usually more of our participants in the judo club are women, typically. So you'll get a lot of body type variation, and just there's always been reporting of people feeling safer after a few practices.
Well, thank you, because I feel safe and I didn't do it, and I hope Brian felt safe as well. Well, thank you so much for taking your time to show us some moves and help us protect ourselves, of course. And that's all we have for this episode of Jack Talk. Thank you for joining us.